Welcome to worship at New Hope Presbyterian Church. We're glad to have you. Thank you so much for bringing the hundreds of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches this week to donate to We Care. We appreciate you, and we'll let you know when our next collection drive is. Last week, we made an exciting announcement. Our Sunday morning worship services are now going to include ministry for our early childhood and elementary school students beginning Sunday, September 13th. You can check out the details on our website or in your e-news this week. If you'd like to continue your generosity in giving to God's kingdom, we have four ways for you to do that. Number one, you can text to give. Number two, you can give online. Both ways are secure and protect your privacy. You're also welcome to mail us a paper check at the address you see on your screen. Or if you're worshiping on campus with us, you're welcome to drop it off in the lobby as you exit. All right, Pastor Mike is bringing us the word today, and we're excited you're worshiping with us. Let's go.
Is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwell. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us.
The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Thank you.
this prayer. Stand up and bless the Lord your God from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name, which was exalted above all blessing and praise. You are the Lord alone. You have made heaven, the heaven of heavens with all their host, the earth and all that is in it, the seas and all that are in them, and you preserve all of them. And the host of heaven worships you. You are the Lord, and we worship you, our Lord and Creator. Amen. Seated. We call ourselves to confession today with the words from Hebrews chapter 12. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin that so easily entangles us. And let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Let us pray together using the words of Psalm 77. I cry aloud to God, and he will hear me. In the day of my trouble, I seek the Lord. In the night, my hand is stretched out with wearying. My soul refuses to be comforted. When I remember God, I moan. When I meditate, my spirit faints. Our God, may we cry aloud, stretching out our hands. We remember you and meditate on our sin and troubles, now and in your holy presence.
In the morning when I rise,
God has not left us in our trespasses and sin, but instead he has given us Jesus. He was born, he lived, he died, and he is resurrection. And in him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Please stand with me as we affirm our faith with this ancient Scottish statement of faith. We worship you, eternal God, Father. We call on you, eternal Son. We confess you, Holy Spirit, dwelling in one divine unity. To you, O Trinity, we give praise and thanks. To you, one God, we sing in endless praise. To you, Father unbegotten, to you, the only begotten Son, to you, Holy Spirit, proceeding from the Father and the Son, we confess with our hearts to you beyond all thought, surpassing all understanding. To the all-powerful God, we give thanks, who reigns now and forevermore. Amen.
To the Lord.
may be seated.
Well, it is great to be together in the house of the Lord. It was really fun being down there hearing everyone sing this morning. It just sounded like a chorus. And so thank you if you're here in the room with us today. Thank you so much for joining us in this house of the Lord. If you're at home today joining with us and joining your voices with us, praise God that you're here. Thank you that you've come together to worship God. I want to thank especially Katie and Ben for all the wonderful, wonderful music that we get to enjoy every week. I think it'd be appropriate if we just offered a thank you to them. And Brad as well, thank you so much for stepping in at the last moment. Appreciate it so very much. You know, when Katie was singing that song, Give Me Jesus, it took me back to a time probably about maybe 10 years ago. We had started a church in Tampa, Florida. My wife and I had started a church. And God was bringing together a bunch of folks. And by His grace and by His providence, they were mostly young folks. But we did have one lady who came. She was a friend of a friend of a friend. And she came to join with us at 86 years old. Now, in Tampa, that's very, very unusual. But what was doubly unusual about her, she had never been, quote unquote, a Christian. She had never heard the gospel. 86 years old in America had never heard the gospel. She came and she engaged with the gospel. She engaged with the people of our church called Hope. It's ironic that this is New Hope. That church was Hope. And she just grew in her faith and grew in her understanding of who Jesus was. She was discipled by the church, and she, 3 years later, passed away at 89 years old, and yet she had such a beautiful faith that I know that I'll see Nikki again in heaven. And the reason I bring that up is because at her funeral, that song was sung, Give Me Jesus. And as I was sitting there enjoying the beauty of that song, the way that Katie had interpreted it, it brought me back to that blessed funeral, that grace-filled funeral of my dear sister Nikki. You know, music can do that, can't it? A song you can hear and experience in one place can just transport you to another place all at once, can't it? It's those songs that you hear, and maybe that was your high school song, and all of a sudden you hear it on the radio, and you're not driving the car anymore. You're back in high school. Or it might have been a song that was played at your wedding reception, the song that you and your spouse danced to, and all of a sudden when you hear it come on, you're transported to another place. Isn't that the way it goes? Well, I call those songs soundtracks for life, because it's not just a song, it's an experience. And it takes you back to a completely different place just by hearing that song. And all of a sudden, the smells and the feels and the way the weather was and what you're wearing, everything just comes flooding back at a memory, doesn't it? Soundtracks for life. This morning, we're going to be talking about a soundtrack for life in James chapter 1. You know, these are very, very challenging times, aren't they? And I will just say this, if you're would be more comfortable without your mask on during this time of the service, our facilities team has worked very hard to create a safe distance for you. So if you would like to drop it down, you can. If you're at home, I doubt you're wearing a mask anyway, but if you want to take it off, you can. That's up to you. So these are strange times, as you can tell just by looking around and seeing the masks on people's faces. As we drive out and we see what usually are crowded spaces are pretty much empty. These are strange times. But these are times, think about this. This is the time, this is the place, this is the place that God has created for us to be in. He is allowing us to write the story of how we as individuals, we as a church, even we as a nation, respond to these times. I've titled this message today, What to Do When You Don't Know What to Do, and we're going to look at it from James' perspective. Now, I want to give you a little bit of background about who James was. James was the half-brother of Jesus. He was a little bit late to the party. In fact, if you read in the Gospels, you read there was a time when it says Jesus was preaching and telling everyone who he was and talking about the kingdom of God and all this other stuff. And there's this little passage that says, they came to him and they said, Jesus, your mother and brothers are here to take you home. And what they really mean by that is, Jesus, those who know you best are here to say, you ain't who you think you are. James was one of those. And yet later in life, God used James as a pivotal point, as a foundation for the early church. Let's just see a little bit of who he is. James, he was the half-brother of Jesus, a later son of Mary and Joseph. Now I have a brother. I love my brother to death. He is absolutely wonderful. I would do just about anything for him, but I know he is not God. James was the half-brother of Jesus, grew up in the same household as Jesus. And yet because of what Jesus had done by being beaten, hung on the cross, 3 days later, rising from the dead, James said, he is God. He is God. He was the half-brother he became head of the Jerusalem church. He was a pillar, a foundation of the Jerusalem church in the first century. He was called a pillar of the early church, and the other leaders looked to him. In fact, the Apostle Paul, on his first visit to Jerusalem, went immediately to see James. He did the same on his last visit to Jerusalem. James was a player in the first century church. When Peter was rescued from prison, he told his friends to be sure and tell James. James was a leader in the very, very important Council of Jerusalem that decided many of the things that we hold on to today as faith and doctrine. He was so well known that Jude could simply call himself a brother of James. Everybody knew who James was. Tradition has it that he was known as Old Camel Knees. Isn't that interesting? Because of the thick calluses he had built on, because of his hours and hours and hours in prayer. Tradition also has it that he was martyred through a beheading around 62 AD when Nero was persecuting the Christians. James knew Jesus. James, when he comes to us with this teaching, this admonition, if you will, this is how you get through those tough times, James knew what he was talking about. James had seen things in the persecution. James had gathered people under the persecution. James had street cred. He knew what he was talking about. And so in James chapter 1, we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 18 today. In James chapter 1, he comes along and he says, when you're in trouble, when you don't know what to do, consider it all joy. Look at what he says in 1 through 4. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, greetings. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Now think about the biggest trial that's facing us today. Arguably, it would be COVID-19. It could be the social unrest. It could be the economic fallout that's going to fall on the other side of COVID-19. There are many, many stresses that could be hounding us today, catching our attention, causing us to be distracted. And for a moment, I want you to think beyond COVID-19 and think about what other stresses might be out there. There may be marital stresses. There may be financial stresses. There may be career stresses. There may be relationship stresses. There may be health stresses. Think about any of those troubles that have a tendency to pour down on us. It's kind of like that old commercial. Remember, I think it was the long-haired guy. He was on a boat. Remember, and it comes on, and he says, life comes at you fast and hard. Life does come at us fast and hard. And when we get in those situations, we have a choice. James tells us to consider it joy. And we hear that and we go, how in the world could that possibly be? The New Living Translation takes that word consider, and it says, consider it an opportunity for joy. And it's interesting, in the original Greek, that word for face, when you face troubles of any kind, that word is translated, when you walk into, when troubles find you, when you come across something and it's just on top of you. In their case, it may have been persecution. In our case, it may be COVID-19. He says, consider it an opportunity for joy when you run into these type of situations, when these situations simply overtake you. How could we possibly consider it joy? Notice that he says it's joy, not happiness. It's joy, not happiness. Happiness is a feeling. It's fleeting. You can have happiness at Disney World and then drive home and have a flat tire and it's not so happy anymore. But joy is a perspective. Joy is founded in something real and solid. He doesn't say consider it all happiness. Don't put on a fake smile. He says consider it all joy. And he says it this way in the New Living Translation. He says, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. You know the difference between happiness and joy in this situation? Perspective. Perspective. Looking at the situation and saying, God, I know this isn't all there is to it. I know there's something on the other side. I know that you are about something. You're doing something here. None of this is wasted. And he says, get the right perspective. Consider what's happening and what's happening inside of you. He says, God is using these things to complete you. In nature, it's called the adversity principle. The adversity principle says an existence without challenge is not healthy. All you have to do is go to a zoo and see the animals who are used to chasing after food all the time get their food brought to them and they put on some weight. And that, I'm not saying anything about COVID pounds right now. I'm just talking about something else here. You see it in a tree. It's really interesting in the rainforest. There's these tall, tall, tall trees, and yet their roots are only about 2 feet deep. It's because the water is right there at the top. They don't have to dig deep to get the water. And guess what? When a storm blows through, those 60-foot trees topple over. There's no root. There's no need for it because the water is right there. Compare that to trees that are growing out in the desert, trees that are growing on the sides of mountains where they have to dig deep, deep, deep roots to get to the water. That's what James is saying here. He's echoing Psalm 1. Blessed is the man who doesn't listen to the counsel of the ungodly, but he is like a tree who is planted by the water and its root is deep. That's what James is saying here. Just sort of as an aside, let me ask you something right quick. What holds up a tree? Think about it. What holds up a tree? Somebody say it out. You can say it at home. You can say it here. What holds up a tree? The roots? If it's the roots, then why after a storm can you drive by and see trees uprooted with all their roots exposed where they have fallen out of the ground? I would challenge you and say that it's not the roots that hold up the tree. It's the dirt. It's the dirt around the roots. Could it be that COVID-19 is building more dirt around the roots of God's church? Could it be that COVID-19 and everything that we're about to face and have faced is adding more dirt around the roots of our faith? Could it be that that's what God is doing right now in your situation? Adding dirt around those roots so that your foundation will be even more firm. Very, very famous quote from C.S. Lewis says this. He says, God whispers to us in our pleasures. He speaks to us in our conscience, but he shouts in our pain. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. How can we consider it all joy? How can we consider it an opportunity for joy? It's about perspective. What is God doing in the midst of these troubles? In fact, I want to propose a little. There's an uprooted tree right there. Nothing wrong with the roots. You know, this whole crisis is exposing to us maybe some of our own roots, some of what's going on around us. Barna did a recent, the polling group Barna did a recent study of post-COVID church attendance online. And what they found was that as this keeps on going, we keep shedding. You see, not only do we have a soundtrack for life, we have a story for life. Right now, we are writing the story. We are writing the story of how we and how the church and how our world is facing this crisis. It's a national story, and this picture shows that it's a little dicey for national. 50% of millennials who used to tune in the beginning of the COVID crisis are now finding a different way of expressing their faith. 35% of Gen X, and over 20% of boomers are not attending online church anymore. That could be because they're like you, they're in the room. That could be because other things have come up. Just letting the facts speak. That's the national story. It's also a New Hope story. What story are we writing as New Hope Church? This just shows how many folks are tuning in from our own church family throughout COVID. I offer this to encourage you to say, all we see here is not all we see. God is writing a powerful story through New Hope Church of giving, a powerful story of serving. You heard about the sandwiches that we're coming together to bring to those who are in need. There are many, many, many other stories of the way that New Hope Church is stepping up and serving and praying and connecting and staying together as the body of Christ. That's the story that we are writing right now in the midst of COVID. But there's also a personal story. There's a personal story. What personal story are you writing? What story will your kids and your grandkids tell about how you personally got through this trial or any other trial? You see, in a trial, you'll either turn to God or turn away from God. In a trial, you'll either turn to Him and say, where else would I go? Or you'll turn away and say, tried that, didn't work. What story will you be telling? So I want to just propose a little bit of a sequence here from James 1. James says, a trial will come. You can choose to endure. And then at the end of that, God will complete in you something that He wants done. Trial, choose to endure, complete. But that's all great and good, but what do I do? What do I do when I don't know what to do? And so James goes on in verse 5, and he says, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all that they do. What should you do when you don't know what to do? You should ask God for wisdom. You should ask God for wisdom. Now, wisdom is that thing that says, this is what you do. But honestly, when we're in the middle of a trial, don't we want knowledge? Don't we really want knowledge? Don't we want knowledge that says, God, as long as I understand what you're doing here, if I could just know how long this is going to last, if I could just get a read on how you're going to resolve this, if I just knew the why. See, that's knowledge. And in the midst of a trial, isn't it knowledge that we want more than wisdom? Isn't it knowledge that says, if I only knew what was up, then I could choose whether or not I wanted to obey? And that's why God says, I'm not going to give you that. I'm going to give you wisdom. Because wisdom says, I will follow. I will follow, even if I don't understand. You see, that's what James is saying. He said, we should ask, and then we should do it. We should ask, and then we should do it. Another way he put it here, knowledge asks why. Wisdom says, I don't necessarily need to know why. I just ask, what? Paul put it this way. He says, we walk by faith, not by sight. We would love to know in the midst of that trial what it's going to look like. And God says, You come to me, you ask, I'll give you wisdom, and then you walk. See, there's a huge difference. There's a huge difference between agreement and obedience. Agreement says, give me my options. I'll choose that one. Obedience says, I'll follow you. I will follow you. Isaiah reminds us that God's ways are higher than our ways. God's ways are higher than our ways. He is doing something that we don't necessarily understand. And at that point, we have a choice. We can see it as an opportunity to grow in our faith, or we can say, I'm not interested. I'm going to do something else. James says, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God who loves to give it. And I love the way that he says it that way. He says, God is not going to say, you again? What? I told you last time. He says, no, he's not going to cast you out. He's not going to turn you away. He's going to say, I'll keep giving it. I'll keep giving it. I'll keep giving it. But you got to do what I tell you. Do you remember years ago there was a little bumper sticker that said, God is my co-pilot? Did anybody ever else see that one? What a crazy thing. God's not my co-pilot. He's my pilot. That's what James is saying here. He's saying, we don't go to God as an advisor. We go to God as a source of truth. We go to God as the source of wisdom. We go to God as the one who knows the way that this is going to turn out. And then we come trusting and we say, God, I don't understand, but I don't have to understand. I don't have to know the way, because you are the way. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the light. When we come to him, we got to come with that mindset. It's very interesting because, you see, that word for double-minded, that word for double-minded in there is the word for two-souled, S-O-U-L-E-D, souled. Two-souled, it means that you're chasing one way and then chasing another way. Years ago when my daughter was real small, she was maybe 4 years old, and if you've got kids and you remember, that's just a talkative age. You know what I'm saying? They're just gushing on and on and on. And one day she was sitting in her little booster chair thing and she was eating red Jell-O. I remember it really well. And I'm sitting there just listening and enjoying the moment. My phone went off and there was an email or something that really wasn't that important. I picked up my phone. I started reading it. And Anna looked at me with her little jelloed hands, grabbed my cheeks, turned my face back to her and said, Daddy, I talk, you listen. That's the way God is. When he says, when you come to me and you ask for wisdom, there aren't other options. You're not seeking me among others. When you come to me, not double-minded, not two-souled, not distracted, God, you talk. I listen. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should come to God. He loves to give it. But when you do, don't come as a double-minded person. Listen and do it. And so we'll increase our little paradigm here. James says, there's a trial. Choose to endure it. Ask for and follow wisdom, and he will make it complete. You know, there was a time in John chapter 6 when Jesus had this huge following of people. All of these folks were gathering around, and all of these, he was just like a rock star. And I mean, people would just show up. And he taught on what it meant to truly follow him. And he said, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you got no part of me. And people were like, what? Oh, no, that's too much, Jesus. No, no. And many of them fell away, is what the scripture said. Many of them fell away. And Jesus turned to his people, to his disciples and he said, are you going to leave too? And Peter answered him and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You alone have the words of eternal life. In the midst of your crisis, in the midst of our crisis, in the midst of this trouble, where else are we going to go? Jesus, you alone have the words of eternal life. God, you alone have the wisdom. You alone have the perspective. You know the beginning from the end. Where else would we go? If any of us lacks wisdom, we should go to God and ask, because he loves to give it. But when we do, we need to come single-mindedly and saying, God, yes, sir. Yes, if that's what you want, then that's what I will do. Then James goes in verses 9 to 11, and it seems like he changes gears all of a sudden. He's talking about all of this wisdom, and then all of a sudden he starts talking about rich people and poor people. You know what he's doing here? He says, believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. Humble circumstances means they're poor. Humble circumstances means they're powerless. Humble circumstances means they've got nowhere to lean except on God. But in the world's eyes, humble circumstances look like God's not blessing. In the world's eyes, it looks like God has forgotten them and he's blessing the rich folks over here because they don't have the same problems. And James uproots that argument and he says, but the rich should take pride in their humiliation since they will pass away like a wildfire, for the sun rises with scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossoms fail and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich will fade away even while they go about their own business. He's saying, you can't take it with you. He's saying, all that stuff that you've accumulated, the house, the boat, the cars, the iPods, the iPads, the latest computers, all those things, you can't take it with you. And he's saying, instead of focusing on these things that are temporary, he says, thank God for the poor folks who understand that God is teaching them something about their faith, that God is growing their faith, that they're growing in their character of Jesus Christ, because that's the only thing that matters in the end. Years ago, I was at Signal Mountain Presbyterian Church, an EPC church in Signal Mountain, Tennessee. Absolutely beautiful place. God has blessed that congregation with incredible generosity and incredible resources. There was a missionary there from Haiti right after the horrific earthquake there that just destroyed the country. And Felipe was there, and he was giving the message about how many needs there were in his country. And I'll never forget, the pastor got up and prayed for Felipe, and he said, oh, we pray for you in your poverty that God would provide. And Felipe, after the prayer, stood up and he said, I thank you so much for praying for us. But may I pray for you in your riches, that you don't trust your riches, but you trust in the grace of Jesus Christ. Folks, that's our story. That's who we are. That's who we are as a church. That's who we are as people. We are writing a story about how we will endure these trials. Let's make sure it's a story worth telling. And then James goes on from there. He goes on from there, and he finishes out the paradigm. And he said, choose a trial, choose to endure, ask for wisdom, and then do it. God will make your faith complete, and then he'll give you the crown of life. Listen to what he says in James chapter 1. He said, blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. You see, there is an end in sight, and it is a crown of life. And Scripture says that we will take those crowns one day and cast them as an offering before our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. How we write this story now influences the way that we will wear that crown of life. In fact, it's interesting, that crown of life, as it's described there, was an athletic term. It was the laurel, the ivy crown that was put on the winning athlete, because he says, having stood the test, We hate that word, don't we? We hate that word. We don't want to be tested on anything. And yet James chose that word specifically by the Holy Spirit to remind us that trials test our endurance. And our endurance, when it's fully formed, completes our faith. And our faith, when it's all said and done, produces the crown of life that God has promised to us who love Him. Well, James goes on from there and he talks a little bit more about temptation. Because you see, when we're in that trial, don't we want to blame somebody? Isn't it just human nature to look at it and say, if only, or it's all their fault, or it's somebody else's fault? And ultimately, if left to ourselves, we will never blame ourselves, but we're tempted to blame God. Anybody else ever tempted to blame God for something? Looking at a situation and saying, you could do something about that if you just would. If you just would. James uproots that conversation as well, and he says it this way. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does He tempt anyone. We need to say that together. Let's just, if you're at home, say it out loud. God does not tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. You see, that's another paradigm. That's another paradigm that James is introducing there, that desire leads to sin, leads to death. And so many times we can get on that treadmill of just running and running and running, and that's why 1 John 1:9 says it this way. He says, confess your sins. Confess those sins so that they don't lead to death. He says, confess those sins because God, who is just, will forgive those sins by the grace and by the blood and the sacrifice and the life and the death of Jesus Christ our Lord. And he says, I will cleanse you from all. Forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. You see, endurance is a process. Eugene Peterson says it this way. It's about a long obedience in the same direction. You may stumble, you may fall, but by the grace of God, you are forgiven, cleansed, and brought back into the race to keep going. That's why when we gather, many times we will pray a prayer of confession. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Oh, what a great hope we have. What a great God we serve. Well, he goes on from there. And he talks about the God who gives good gifts. The God who gives good gifts. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all He created. How do we choose to endure when times get tough? We get a perspective that says, God, you're up to something here. God, I don't know what it is. I'm not sure exactly what you're doing through this COVID-19, but already, even from my limited perspective, I can see a few blessings. I don't know what you're going to do in this economic upheaval, but I'm trusting you. I'm asking you for wisdom. I'm asking you for guidance, and then I'm planning to do what you reveal to me. I don't know why you choose to bless some folks more than other folks, but I understand one thing. I'm not taking it with me. What you're doing in and around me, what you're doing in and around our church is for our good, because you are a good God. All good things come from you, the Father of lights. All these things you are using, you are turning, you are making to work together for good, because we love you and we're called according to your purposes. So there's a trial. We choose to endure. We pray for wisdom and we do what it says. We follow him. He completes our faith. We receive the crown of life. Praise God for James 1. I tell you, it's the gospel story. So what does that mean? There was an admiral named Jim Stockdale. Some of you from the who lived through the Vietnam era might remember him. Some have maybe studied him at business school or anything else. Jim Stockdale was a pilot, a Navy pilot, and was shot down over North Vietnam during the war. He was taken to what they called the Hanoi Hilton. 7.5 years he spent in that wretched, wretched, wretched jail in horrible conditions. You could go back and read his story. It is deplorable the way that he was treated. And yet, through it all, he retained faith that he would prevail in the end. Regardless of the difficulties, at the same time, confront the most brutal facts of your current reality, whatever they may be. That became known as the Stockdale paradox. That is a way that we can approach life and see the way that God is working out in these situations. But there's another part of that story. He was asked in a later book, how did you even get that kind of perspective? How did you even think about the way that, day by day by day, 7.5 years, how did you make it through each day? And he said, I never lost faith in the end of the story. Let me ask you this morning, have you lost faith in the end of the story? Have you been so focused on what's happening right now, which is tragic, which is, I mean, COVID-19 notwithstanding, many of you are facing difficulties that I cannot even imagine. Many of you are facing health difficulties. You're facing decisions that you never thought you would have to make. You're facing relational difficulties. You've got children that are running awry. You've got financial situations. You've got so much pressure. I don't know what it is. But let me ask you this morning, have you lost faith in the end of the story? Or is your faith grounded, rooted deeply in the author of our faith? Someone asked Admiral Stockdale, they said, where did you get the inspiration for that? And we prayed it earlier today. He said, Hebrews chapter 12. Run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Run with perseverance. Endure, no turning back. Endure, keeping our eyes on the prize, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy, not the happiness, for the joy set before him, he could look past the cross. He could look past the grave. He could look past and see us gathered his body together today. He could see seated right at the right hand of God the Father. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. I don't know what you're facing today, but I know my God does. I don't know where you're tempted to give up, but I know my God does. I don't know where you need wisdom, but I know my God will give it. If you'll turn to him without a double heart, if you'll come to him and say, Jesus, you are the only way, you are the only truth, you are the only light. I lean into you. Take these burdens. Take this race. Let me fix my eyes on you and not on the problem. Let me see you high and lifted up in the midst of all of these things. If that's you today, I want you to just join us in this prayer. Gracious God, we come to you this morning. We come to you full of fears, full of doubt, full of things that could potentially derail us and get our eyes off of you. And so, Father, we pray that by your power, by your grace, by your presence, and by your mercy, we would fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Father, I don't know what someone either in the room or online is facing today, but I know that you are bigger than that. Whatever it is, you are bigger than that. And so, Father, I pray for that person that they would seek you with their whole heart for wisdom, for grace in our hour of need, for perseverance, Lord, for that one who is tempted to just give up. I ask, Father, that you would renew, as it says in Psalm 51, that you would renew a right spirit within them, that you would restore the joy of your salvation. And God, if there's anyone that has not yet turned to you, that has not yet come completely to you, that is looking to you as a counselor but not as a savior, I pray, Father, that you would move in their heart right now to confess with their lips that Jesus is Lord, that you are Lord of the universe, that you are Lord of the problem, and that you are Lord of their life. Thank you, Lord, for what you are doing in this time. Thank you for trusting us as people and as your church to carry your story through this time. We thank you. We bless you. We love you in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand together to sing our closing prayer? And now receive the benediction. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. And may you overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. Amen.